Good morning. Welcome to Northview this morning. Glad to have everybody with us. If you're visiting with us, we would love it if you would fill out one of the cards that are there in the pew and put that in the basket in the back. We'd love to be able to make contact with you and know that you're with us. Several of announcements this morning, so I'm just going to go through a few. We had a called administrative board meeting directly after the service. There's an item of business we need to take care of today. So if those of you on the administrative board could meet here in the center section directly after the service, we'll be quick, but we need to handle that. Also, trustees meeting will be tomorrow evening at 7, and that is in person for those of you on trustees. Let's see, UMW, the United Methodist Women, will be meeting this Thursday, December 9th at 2 o'clock. And please bring snacks to share. This will kind of be your Christmas event. But there is a change in the room. It's going to be in the Pathfinder Sunday School classroom. So please, those of you who come to that. We had an issue with the lights flashing last week, and that can really bother some of us. So if that happens again and it bothers you, please raise your hand and we will, so that we know and we'll take care of that in case somebody doesn't catch it. Okay, a couple more things. Today is communion, so please, if you need gluten-free, we have that, and just let an usher know to give you the gluten-free communion kit. And also for the Jordans, I think some of you may have ordered from Devin fundraiser orders. Those are finally arriving this week, and Susan's going to get that to you as soon as possible after that comes in. Okay, let me check. All right. Anything else, anybody? Yes, ma'am.
I would like to thank everyone for all their prayers and calls and hearts.
Good to see Miss Ginger back with us. Debbie Ginger's back, and she appreciates everybody's calls and prayers. Jane?
Hermitage, which is a United Methodist home, is having a beautiful display called Festival of Lights. If you've got children, they need to come by. It's every night from now until January, I think the second week of January, or third week of January. Santa won't be there like he was yesterday when Gary and I waited for 2 hours with all the children. But it's a wonderful thing to go and see that. It's right off Melrose Avenue. So I encourage everybody to see it.
Any other announcements this morning? So let's proceed with our service. Thank you.
Thank you.
morning. It's from Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, and that can be found on page 1490 in the Pew Bible. See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in the days gone by, as in former years. Our second lesson today is in the hymnal, page 208, and we will be reading responsibly. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to set the chosen people free.
The Lord has raised up for us a mighty Savior from the house of David.
Through the holy prophets, God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all who hate us.
To show mercy to our forebears, and to remember the holy covenant.
This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham.
To set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship without fear, holy and righteous in the Lord's sight, all the days of our life.
And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way.
To give God's people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins.
In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us.
To shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Our New Testament lesson is found in Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 11, and that is on page 1825. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. For whether I'm in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God.
Does your tree at home have white or colored lights? White, are they still like this or flash? Okay, so they're still, they don't flash. Do you have any ornaments that you made? What does it look like? Oh, cool. How about any that your sister made? Okay, what do they look like? Okay. So, do you have any that go back to like your parents that they would have made? It's hard to keep because they can be kind of fragile. We had an angel that we put on top of the tree when I was your age that my oldest sister made when she was about your age now. And we used to refer to it as the cross-eyed angel because the way she did it looked like the eyes were looking at each other. And eventually, it just disintegrated. I brought an ornament today that I put on the tree at home, and it's a chrismon. And chrismons that adorn this tree are always white and gold. Those are the two colors that we use. And I was about your age when I was given this as a gift from a woman who was in the church that my family attended. And she made all these chrismons to go on the tree at the church and gave one to us as well. And these ornaments and chrismons, as I said, wear out over time, so we need to make some new ones. And none of the youth and children we have in the church now have had the experience of making anything like this recently. So we're going to do that on Saturday. We'll gather with all the other children and youth of the church, and Miss Linda will have a little workshop, and we'll all make new chrismons. Okay. Will you pray with me? Dear God, bless our children, the families that bring them to church, and the church that surrounds them with love and prayer. Amen. Our hymn of preparation is verses 5 to 7 of O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, found at 211 in your hymnals. Please stand as you read.
We are going to see the King.
last week we looked at Jeremiah, who was talking to those who are in the kingdoms of Israel and Judah before the period of time when a foreign empire would invade them. Once they were invaded, they were then dispersed throughout the empire. This was a way of preventing rebellion among people who had been captured. Today's passage from Malachi comes about 50 or 60 years later. It speaks to those who are in exile, who are about to return home to the land of their parents and their grandparents. The empire had extended beyond its ability to sustain itself, and that was the reason the king returned these people back home. Jeremiah takes aim at the kings, whom he saw as being corrupt and immoral, and someone who set a bad example for the people. Malachi, though, focuses on the priests. The priests at this point had been lamenting that they did not feel like God was with them, or that the God they had been worshiping and preparing sacrifices for even existed. Malachi calls them out on that and accuses them of being hypocritical. He says that they are corrupt. They took more than they should have for themselves when they offered sacrifices, and some even received carnal favors. It's because they have not lived into their sacred duty that they feel the way they do now. And Malachi offers a word of redemption for these priests, but it's a type of redemption that's going to be very costly. There are two images used in the passage today. One is what the NRSV refers to as a fullered soap. What the translation read this morning said was a laundered soap. This is an image, if you think about people in primitive cultures, women who would go down to the creek and rinse out and use some type of soap to wash garments. Garments that people may have only had one or two of and had to wear day after day. The washing would have been a thorough brushing, a rinsing out in the creek, and then beating it against the rock. The other image is that of metal being purified, metal being heated up so that it becomes liquid, and then the impurities bubble up to the surface. So the rinsing out, the wringing and beating of clothes that are being laundered, and the heating of gold and silver until all of the impurities are burned off, that's the image of redemption that Malachi offers the people. They are going to be redeemed. They're going to be clean and made like new, but it's going to come at a cost. Now, we believe and we understand that redemption and forgiveness are free gifts from God. They come to us in the form of God's grace. God loves us and is forgiving because it's in God's nature to do so, and not because we've done anything to earn it. And it's ours to freely accept or to reject if we choose. But what happens when we don't feel forgiven and we still feel guilty and remorseful after we have received God's grace, if we still feel somewhat tarnished and dirty? Well, first of all, go easy on yourself if that's how you feel. Recognize that means you are taking very seriously what you've done or what you've neglected to do. And you're also taking the grace of God very seriously. Because you and I wouldn't ask God for forgiveness if we didn't want God to give us something we couldn't give ourselves. Grace comes to us as a free gift, washing us and making us clean. But if we still feel guilty or remorseful, that's when the church gives us the gift of penance. Works and things that we do in order to feel as forgiven as we are. Now, sometimes the practice of penance which in the Roman Catholic Church is a sacrament, is misviewed as a people's way of trying to work to earn their own forgiveness. That's not something that any denomination teaches. But rather, it's a way to condition ourselves. So in that tradition, when a priest offers forgiveness and absolution, the penance is what is done afterwards in order to replace bad habits with good, or in order to feel the forgiveness that God has offered us. There's a very powerful illustration of this in the Academy Award-winning movie, The Mission. Jeremy Irons plays the leader of a group of Jesuit missionaries during the colonial period in Brazil. Robert De Niro plays a slave trader, and the two encounter each other, first of all, deep in the jungle, where De Niro has gone to capture and enslave some of the natives and sell them into slavery. De Niro gets involved with a woman who's involved with another man, and the two men have a duel, and it results in De Niro killing the other man. He then flees and seeks sanctuary with Jeremy Irons and the rest of the Jesuits. He is taken into their order as a novice, and then they go back out into the jungle to face the very people that he had once tried to enslave. And as his penance, De Niro has all of the armor and the weapons that he used to take with him in the slave trade and into battle, wrapped up in what looks like a huge spider web made out of very thick cords of rope. And it's tied at the end of a rope to a sash that goes around his shoulders. And barefoot, he drags this huge ball of metal all the way deep into the jungle. He walks over very rough rocks where his feet are cut. He walks up muddy embankments where he falls back down on himself. He goes through such punishing work that another one of the brothers comes to Jeremy Irons' character. And he says, we've all talked and we think that he suffered enough and we believe that his penance should be ended. But Jeremy Irons rightly says, yes, but he doesn't feel forgiven yet. And De Niro continues to make the journey until he climbs up the side of a waterfall. And when he's finally there on the embankment and he falls down completely exhausted, the natives very cautiously come out of the woods. And the head of the tribe comes up to De Niro, recognizing him, and very angrily approaches him and pulls a sword out of the bundle of weapons that he had been carrying. And in a very anxious moment, he lifts it up over his head, and then he brings it down and cuts the rope. And he takes the bundle of armor and weapons and rolls it over the embankment so it splashes into the river. And De Niro, who is on his knees, begins to laugh and cry at the same time. In a performance that I can't adequately describe, he looks as if he is feeling every emotion a human being can feel all at once. And slowly the natives surround him and begin to embrace him. That's an example of what forgiveness feels like. When you and I have done things for which we know we are forgiven, but for which we do not feel forgiven, we have the gift of penance to work things out through the guidance of the Holy Spirit to feel as forgiven as we are. As I pointed out last week, our traditional color for this time of year is the dark purple, the same color as Lent. And Advent gives us a special opportunity to do some penance, to work on some things that have been undone all year long or longer than that, to condition ourselves to feel forgiven by God. This is a time of year that churches and charities see their contributions go up. It's kind of funny when you look at the giving record for any nonprofit. It's fairly steady, and then there's a huge spike in December. as everybody suddenly wants their tax deduction, or the procrastinators just remember that they haven't fulfilled that pledge to that church or that organization they were going to. If you have some sense of regret or guilt over something you have or have not done, perhaps there is some charity or ministry at this time of the year that addresses what you feel like you have done, that you can contribute to. Oftentimes, the situations that don't make us feel forgiven involve other people, people who may have been very close to us at one time, from whom we're now estranged. Christmas gives us a good opportunity to just contact people out of the blue with a few lines and a Christmas card, or a carefully written letter, or a phone call, to connect with that person with whom you feel estranged. If you feel some sense of remorse or ill will against someone who has died, then allow the Holy Spirit to guide you to sit down and write a carefully written letter, giving out everything that's in your heart and on your mind. And when you feel like you've said all you need to do, place that in God's hands, fold up that letter, and put it on top of a blazing Yule log. There are many things that we can potentially do penance. Sometimes we look out to each other in the Protestant tradition of the priesthood of all believers, helping one another work out these issues. And other times the Holy Spirit simply implants something in your heart and you know what to do. Our Heavenly Father continues to beckon us and invite us to accept forgiveness and to embrace repentance. Christ our Lord shows us the ultimate lengths that God will do to offer us redemption and forgiveness. And the Holy Spirit works with us gently as we carry on the sacred work of penance during this season of Advent. Amen. Our affirmation of faith is found in the bulletin, the Apostles' Creed traditional version. Join me to recite this historic confession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead, He ascended to heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Bryant, who wrote, George is still on a ventilator and completely sedated, so he won't try to pull out the ventilator tube. We're waiting to see what lab tells us about what is the problem in his lungs so that they will know how to treat it correctly. We both appreciate all the love and prayers that all of you have expressed. What other prayer concerns would you like to lift up?
My coworker, Courtney, her brother-in-law had to be airlifted on Thursday down to Winston-Salem with some complications with diabetes. And he's in his early 50s, I think, a little younger than she is.
We also had a preschool child who on Thursday night was involved in an accident and had a concussion and was taken to the hospital and has been properly diagnosed. So, did I see another hand over here? Yes, in back.
He found in prayers, he had a tumble this week.
Yes.
And has been glued back together. So we just need to keep him in bubble wrap in prayer.
All right. There are no other concerns. Our prayer today is based on our passage from Malachi. Let's pray. Lord of hosts, we are in the middle of a season of anticipation. Heralds in former years proclaimed your coming. Malachi envisioned you as a fuller soap. John preached about the baptism of repentance from sin while in the wilderness. Rather than seeking redemption, we prefer to hide under the filth of our own sinfulness. What we have done and neglected to do causes us to feel shame. Forgive your people who have not lived up to their end of the covenant you made with Abraham. The scorching of a refiner's fire is followed by the strength and perfection of your righteousness. Lord, you know that confession is painful because it involves truthfulness. Within your grace, we find tenderness and mercy. Give us courage to be honest with ourselves and the faith to accept your forgiveness. Strengthen our fellowship to be as strong as steel. Make us honest and compassionate with each other. Carry on your ministry through this congregation. Send us forth to proclaim the good news that through Christ the world has been redeemed. We offer this prayer in his name, as we praise and taught the disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Our final hymn is in the hymnal, number 196, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Please stand, Jerry.
Thank you.
seated and turn to number 12 in your notes. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin to God and one another.
Merciful God, we can confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. And we have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
Now just take a minute and turn and verbally offer the peace of Christ to one. I've missed that. That looks good. This morning I'm reading from a version of our communion liturgy written for the season of Advent. Your congregational responses in bold will be the same. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. When nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so, with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their attending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You scattered the proud and the imagination of their hearts, and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send away empty. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now the ushers will come forward, and if you'll please make your way on the center aisles to receive the elements, and then circle up around the outside of the section. Amen.